So in the last module, we have discussed about the information theory and source coding part. And in fact, that discussion was very much pertinent in terms of the efficiency of the digital communication system. Now, in the very first lecture, I have told you that in digital communication system, we are bothered in formulating a system which is efficient as well as reliable. So these are the two terms. So once again, let me write it down over here so that you can remember it. So these are the two parameters. One is the efficiency, and the second one was the reliability. Whenever you are going to formulate a digital communication system, set up a digital communication system, your emphasis should be to enhance the efficiency of the system and to increase the reliability of the system. But unfortunately, these two operations cannot be done parallelly. And on the other hand, to some extent, these two operations or these two parameters are contradictory in nature to some extent. Now, let me explain where is this contradiction present. So whenever we talk about the efficiency of the system, while discussing the notion of the source coding or the information theory, we have repeatedly mentioned that efficiency means you have to utilize the available resources in an efficient way. So the available resource for any communication system, as you have repeatedly mentioned, one was the power and the second one was the bandwidth. So these are the two essential components or essential resources. And as you can understand, both of them are not cheap. So if you consider the bandwidth, you have to procure the bandwidth from the government. If I consider a mobile communication system, then the service provider needs to procure that particular amount of bandwidth. This amount of megahertz or this amount of gigahertz, so they need to purchase from the government. So bandwidth is not a parameter which is easily available. Similarly, the power, if I consider, so obviously the power is also not redundantly available. So these are the two important resources. So whenever you do have some resources with you and you have to continue the operation in a digital communication system, so the basic emphasis should be to utilize those different resources in an efficient manner. That means you have to, you can spend those amounts, you can spend power, you can spend bandwidth in an efficient way. So whenever the term efficiency is used, in that particular case, it is very much related to the resources which we have at the beginning. On the other hand, if I consider the term reliability, now the term reliability is very much dependent upon the outcome of the digital communication system. For example, if I would like to represent a communication environment by means of a simple black box, suppose this is the communication environment or communication black box. Or communication system, for example. It can be any communication system, analog or digital. Now the objective, you know, the objective is to transmit the signal from one place to the other place. Now, depending upon the scheme that you invoke, if you go for an analog communication system, in that case, the signal will be transmitted in its raw form. On the other hand, if you consider the digital communication system, then the corresponding signal will be encoded in the forms of zeros and ones, and those zeros and ones will be transmitted through the digital communication channel. But the thing is that you have to transmit the signal from one end to the other end, from the transmitter side to the receiver side. That is the purpose of any communication system. Now to achieve or now to accomplish that particular operation, what do you have? What are the resources? So these are the two resources. One is the power and the second one is the bandwidth. So you do have these two resources and you have to efficiently utilize those resources so that your requirement is fulfilled. Now, on the other hand, if I just consider the output side, what do you have over here? Your job was to transmit the signal from one end to the other end. Now, as far as the digital communication is concerned, now here we will be sending some a bit pattern like this 0 1 0 0 1 like this. You will be sending something from this transmitter side. So this is the transmitter side, and ultimately we should expect that the signal, the bits that we have transmitted, it should be received by the corresponding receiver. So if the signal was like 01001, so you should expect that it will be like 01001 and so on. So the signal, the bits that you have transmitted from the transmitting end, it should be received properly. And the reliability is a kind of term which is very much dependent upon the outcome that you are getting at the receiving end. That means whenever you are sending a set of set of bits in the form of zeros and ones, and whenever you are receiving a set of bits in the form of zeros and ones, now you need to check whether you can or you have received the proper bit or not. Now if you can receive the bits properly, that means your system is reliable. That means you can rely on the system. You have transmitted say 10 to the power 9 bits over here. You have transmitted 10 to the power 9 number of bits from the transmitter side, and you have seen that almost all the bits are received in proper manner. That means 0 has been received as 0 and 1 has been received as 1. Now suppose you have transmitted 10 to the power 9 bits from the transmitter end, and you have observed that out of these 10 to the power 9 bits, you find that one bit is in error. So under this condition, you can find out that the BER will become 10 to the power minus 9. This will be 10 to the power minus 9, the BER. Suppose this is the one case where you find that BER value is equal to 10 to the power minus 9, and BER is nothing but the bit error rate. Now suppose that is the scenario for a particular communication system, let it be communication system 1. And suppose you have performed the same experiment with a different set of system, and for which if you transmit 10 to the power 9 bits, from the transmitter side, perhaps you have observed that out of 10 to the power 9 bits, 10 bits are in error. So last time there were only one bit in error, and this time 10 bits was in error. So in the second case, the corresponding BER value will be nothing but 10 upon 10 to the power minus 9, and which is nothing but 10 to the power minus 8. Now this is for system 1. This is for system 1. And this one is for system 2. So obviously, if you now compare the performance of both of these two systems, you must agree that the first system is better than the second system in terms of the reliability, because your objective is to transmit all the bits from the transmitter side to the receiver side through a channel, through a system. Now while doing that particular operation, since we are talking about a practical communication system, so the noises are inevitable. Our objective is to minimize the effect of noise, but you cannot make it zero. So noise will be there, and accordingly the you will find that there will be some bits which are found in error. But if I consider system 1, system 1 is having only one bit in error whenever the total number of transmitted bit was 10 to the power 9. And on the other hand, for system 2, we have 10 bits in error whenever the total number of bits is same, that is 10 to the power 9. So BER value is high for system 2, and that's why we can say that the system 2 is less reliable as compared to system 1. So reliability is a kind of thing which can be understood from the performance of the system, whether the corresponding bits are properly received at the receiver end or not. So efficiency is a kind of parameter which can be measured from the resource end. That means how can you effectively utilize the resources, and accordingly the efficiency will be measured or will be computed. And on the other hand, the reliability is something to do with the performance of the system. And last day, while talking about the different types of source code, we have mentioned that if I consider the very primitive type of source coding technique, which is known as the Morse code, and if the Morse code is applied on English alphabet, you will find that the corresponding, the number of bits for a particular alphabet is directly proportional to the 1 upon the frequency of occurrence. That means if I consider two different words, rather two different alphabets like E and Q, for example, and since the frequency of occurrence is E, of E is much, much higher as compared to Q, so the corresponding information content against E is much less as compared to the information content of Q. Now, since Q is rare, let me just Since this is rare, so Q is rare. So what we have done? We assign more number of bits, more bits against Q. And since E was frequent, so the idea was to assign less bits against E. And that idea was exploited in case of source coding. Now today I'll be talking about the channel coding, where the channel coding scheme will be developed or has been developed to combat against the channel noise. Now, because of noise, as you understand, if I transmit a 10 to the power 9 number of bits from the transmitter side, there is a possibility that X number of bits may be found in error. So accordingly, the BER value will be X upon 10 to the power 9. So our objective is to minimize the value of X for a given number of transmitted bits. Now, to accomplish that particular task, some redundancy has to be added. Obviously, we need to follow certain rule, we need to follow certain law by means of which these redundancies are added. And accordingly, we are trying to make the entire communication much more protected. So protection is the fundamental idea behind the channel coding. You are sending this amount of bits, say 10 to the power 9 amount of bits from the transmitter side, and you have to, and your system needs to ensure that this 10 to the power 9 number of bits are properly transmitted, and accordingly all of them are received properly at the receiver side. So that means there should have been some protection, and this protection is coming in the form of a channel coding. Now, before discussing the different types of channel coding algorithm, now let me start with the scheme of a channel encoder or the schematic diagram. What do we have actually? So we do have, at the very beginning, we do have some information source, which can, so we do have information source which can emit the bit pattern like zeros and ones, and our objective is to guide those bits in such a way they are not affected by the channel noise. So after the information source, which can generate zeros and ones with a certain data rate, then we do have a channel encoder block. And this channel encoder block, as the name suggests, so we do have a channel encoder over here. And this channel encoder will add some redundancy in a controlled manner, obviously. It will add some controlled redundancy to the bit patterns generated by the information source. And accordingly, it gives more protection against the channel noise. Then ultimately, if I consider a passband kind of modulation scheme or the communication scheme, so we do have a modulator over here. And then the modulated signal will pass through the channel. And ultimately, this will be the channel output. In fact, there are plenty of sub-blocks in between, but for the sake of analysis, let me just focus upon the important blocks over here. So information source, what you understand, it can generate certain bits like this, 0, 1, 0, 0, like this. It will generate the signal in the forms of zeros and ones. Now, to ensure that these signals are, these bits are properly protected during their transmission through the channel, so this channel encoder will add some redundancy in a controlled manner, and accordingly, there could have been different channel coding algorithm. And as a matter of fact, we do have a new type of, suppose 0100, then we should have say 101, for example. So this is the output of the channel encoder, and this bit pattern is being provided at the input of a modulator, a digital modulator. And this modulator will change the carrier frequency from a particular point, from a particular frequency value to a different value. It will modulate this one. And in digital communication system, we do have different types of modulation scheme. We have amplitude shift keying, we have phase shift keying, and we have frequency shift keying. So there could have been different types of modulation. So very briefly, I would like to mention, although these digital modulation schemes are not there included in your syllabus, but still I would like to mention what could have been the different types of modulation. So here the frequency, suppose the carrier frequency is, say, let it be say FC, and here for the pulse, the zeros and ones are being represented by some pulse like this. So as you know, this is the pulse pattern. Suppose I would like to send, say, 110010. So this 110010 is being represented by this particular pulse. So accordingly, if I have a carrier signal like this, this is the carrier signal, high frequency carrier signal having a frequency of, say, FC. Suppose this is having a frequency of FC. Now, we do have different types of modulation scheme. One is known as the amplitude shift keying, or ASK. I think it will be better if I write down the name first. Amplitude shift keying. In which case the amplitude of the carrier signal will be modified in accordance with the amplitude of the pulse pattern. So since these parts are not included in your syllabus, but very briefly, I would like to mention amplitude shift keying or ASK. And the popular method is known as the phase shift keying. That means the phase of the carrier signal is modified in accordance with the input data string, that is 110010. Phase shift keying, or in short PSK. And third option is the frequency shift keying, or FSK. And in fact, this phase shift keying is, this phase shift keying or PSK also have some classification. We do have the BPSK, QPSK. BPSK stands for binary phase shift keying. QPSK stands for quadrature phase shift keying. We do have the other versions of QPSK as well. We do have like 8PSK or 8RPSK. QPSK stands for 4PSK, BPSK stands for 2PSK, 8PSK, 16PSK, and in short, we have MADQPSK, 16PSK, and so on. So these are the different variants of PSK family. And from the QPSK, we do have another variant, which is known as offset QPSK or OQPSK. And we do have a pi by 4 shifted QPSK. So there are different variants of QPSK and PSK family, but I am not going into that. So by means of those modulation technique, what happens is your signal, this 0100101, that particular bit pattern can be transmitted through the channel. And ultimately, we do have a channel output. So this is the transmitter side. So in the receiver side, we do have just the reverse block. So this will be the received signal. And obviously, I would like to mention one point over here, that within the channel, the noise is externally added. So whenever we are talking about the channel, so external noise gets added at this particular point. So external noise is added. So there is a possibility that because of the noise, the corresponding bit pattern might get distorted. And accordingly, we do have devised some channel encoding scheme so that those bit patterns can be protected against any externally present noise signal. So received signal is obtained over here. So at the very beginning, we do have the demodulator, which can once again extract the beat pattern from the signal itself. So since we have the modulator as the last element in the transmitter side, so we do have demodulator over here, and after that we do have a channel decoder. After demodulator, the next block will be channel decoder. So it will follow the reverse channel decoder, and then we have ultimately the source of, I mean, the ultimately it will be the destination. After channel decoder, it will be the destination. So this is the receiver side of any communication environment. So here in this particular module, we will be looking at the channel encoder part. So channel encoder and as well as the channel decoder. So what is the purpose of the channel encoder? So it will add some control redundancies so that the corresponding bit pattern are protected against the externally present noise signal. Now, because of the noise pattern, suppose I am sending a signal like this. Suppose the signal which have been transmitted, the signal is represented by say 110010, and because of the noise, might be this can be received like 110011. For example, that means the last bit is get modified. Zero has been modified to one. So accordingly, the received bit pattern will be 110011. So this 110011 will be received over here. 0100 was the bit pattern generated by the information source, and the channel encoder will add some redundancy, and accordingly, it will generate 0100101. So let us consider another such pattern like 110010. Let it be like let me write over here. Say for example, it was like say 1100. This is the signal generated by the information source and presented at the input of the channel encoder, and the channel encoder accordingly generates say 110010. So that was the bit pattern being generated by the channel encoder, and it has been given to the input of the modulator. And suppose at the output of the demodulator, because of the effect of the external noise, suppose the signal that we receive or the bit pattern that we receive is equal to 110011 instead of 110010. So this 110011, this 110011 will be provided at the input of the channel decoder 110011, and the channel decoder can properly identify the error and it can decode this signal 110011 as 1100. That means we have some essential part that is 1100, and apart from that some redundancy in the form of 10, but that redundancy is edited by some means during the transmission of the signal, and accordingly we are getting like 11. So accordingly, this channel decoder will receive the signal 110011, and ultimately it can properly identify the transmitted symbol or the set of symbols as 1100. In other words, it could have been something like that also. Suppose the second bit is found in error. So 110010 is being received by 100010, and 100010. Suppose this is the 100010. Now, depending upon the channel decoder algorithm, which has been already present over here, the channel decoder can identify that the bit pattern which has been received over here is not the correct one, and from that it can easily identify the correct bit pattern, and the correct bit pattern will be 1100, and accordingly it will be sent to the destination. So this is the purpose as perceived by the channel encoder and channel decoder respectively. Now let us try to identify the operation of channel encoder first. What does it do? So in fact, this channel encoding operation can be divided into two different subcategory depending upon the mathematics behind it. One is known as, so let me just write it down over here, is channel coding. Or it will be better if I just forget about this black box. So the channel encoding, this is the operation, a channel coding. Can be classified broadly into two different classes, two different category. One is known as the block code, and the second one is known as the convolution code. Depending upon their corresponding operations. So first of all, let us try to understand what is meant by the block code. So in case of block code, what happens is a set of bits is being provided at the input of the encoder, and the encoder accordingly adds some control redundancy, and it will generate a corresponding set of output bits. So for block code, the essential feature will be something like that. As you have right now mentioned, so if I have a block code, suppose we have k number of bits, k number of consecutive bits. So you can also consider it as a block of k bits. If I consider 1100, so it's a block of 4 bits. So this block of k number of bits is being provided at the input of the block code, and the block code will generate another block of n bits, where n is greater than k. Because you are adding some redundancies, obviously the number of bits at the input of the block code must be less than the number of bits at the output of the block code. So I can have a combination like n comma k. So the block code is being identified by n comma k. What does it mean? That n is the number of bits at the output of the block coder, and k is the number of bits as the input of the block coder, and it is known as n comma k block code, where n is greater than k. Now suppose the bit rate over here, let it be bit rate is given by say RO, and the bit rate over here, let it be say RS. Then what we find is we have k number of bits with a bit rate is equal to RO. So what will be the total duration? So total duration will be k into RO. So total duration will be k into RO. Now within that particular duration, k into RO, this block code will develop n number of bits at its output. So this n number of bits will be produced. At its output, and the time duration is k into RO. So what will be the rate of bit over here? What will be the bit rate over here at the output side of the block code? So this is nothing but total number of bit is n upon total time is k into R. Just a minute. Yeah, so RO is nothing but the bit rate of the information source and RS is known as the channel code rate. Or sometimes is also known as channel data rate. So So either channel code rate or channel data rate. Channel data rate. So this block code will accept k number of bits. So if I consider, for example, a 7,4 kind of thing. So suppose the bit pattern over here is 1101, and the output side it develops say 1101101, for example. So we have 4 bits at the input of the block code and 7 bits at the output of the block code. That means there is a kind of redundancy. So n comma k is the corresponding representation for the block code, and ultimately the channel data rate is given by RS. So what is the relation between this RO and RS? So let me go to the next slide. So in 1 second, RO number of bits are being generated by the information source. So RO number of bits is generated in 1 second. So therefore, if I have k number of bits, so this k number of bits is generated, simple arithmetic, it will be generated in k by RO second. Now, this k number of bits is being provided at the input of the channel encoder, or more specifically, it is nothing but a block coder, a block encoder. And ultimately, it generates n number of bits. So here, at the output of the block encoder, n number of bits is produced in k by RO second, because the time is the same. N number of bits is being produced in k by RO second. So therefore, if I consider that the RS is the bit rate, then how many bits are being produced in 1 second? So in one second, number of bits generated is given by n by k by RO, that means n by k into RO, and which is nothing but the RS. So therefore, the channel data rate RS is given by n by k into RO, and the code rate here is given by, which is the property of the block encoder. So code rate, which is normally identified by R, small r, is given by k by n, and whose value is always less than 1, because n is higher than k, n is greater than k. Now this is the property of the block encoder. So for block encoder, at a time a chunk of k number of bits are being provided, and this block encoder, using some mathematical formulation, using some mathematical algorithm, it will generate n number of bits at its output, where n is obviously greater than k, and the entire operation is done as block by block basis. So that's why the name is block encoder. So block of k bits is being transformed into block of n bits, and so on. And accordingly, the code rate for this particular block encoder is given by R, that is equal to k by n, which is always less than 1. Now that is the scenario for the block code, which we have already mentioned, and more specifically, another point which I would like to mention over here is that for a block quote, there is no memory. So whenever the key number of present bits is being provided at the input of the block encoder, then depending upon the status of the present k bits, the corresponding n output bits will be generated. So there is no memory. There is no previous information being stored inside the block encoder. On the other hand, if I consider a convolutional code or convolution code, so in case of convolution code, it will accept the bits one by one. So it's a kind of sequential processing. So if I just like to represent the corresponding convolutional code, it is another type of block, channel encoder. This is known as the convolution code. So it will accept the serial bits. So it will accept the bits serially one after another, and there is certain impulse response of this convolutional code which is already being present inside this convolutional code within the encoder block, and accordingly it will generate the output bits, sequential outputs. The sequential outputs are being obtained. So serial bits are being provided. Suppose the bits are like 0 1 0 0 1 0 1 1, and accordingly the corresponding output could have been like, first for 0, the corresponding output could have been 0 1 0, then the next one the output could have been say 1 0 1, then 0 it could have been say 0 1 0, and accordingly the output will be developed. Now while developing the output for this particular convolutional code, since there are certain memory already incorporated inside the convolution code, so apart from the present input bit, the previous knowledge is also incorporated, and since the memory is already there, and accordingly the convolution operation will be performed, and this is also known as a sliding window kind of thing. So we will be discussing that thing in detail while considering the convolutional code, but I would like to mention the basic fundamental difference between a block code and a convolutional code. The thing is that for a block encoder, a block of bits, block of k number of bits are being provided at the input, and block of n number of bits will be generated at the output. On the other hand, for convolutional code, the bits are accepted by the encoder serially, one after another. First 0, then 1, then 0, then another 0, then 1, like this. So first it will accept the bit 0, but sometimes it can also accept two bits at a time, say 0, then 1, then 0, like this. And accordingly, the outputs are being provided sequentially. And the most important difference, the fundamental difference between the block encoder and the convolutional encoder is that in case of convolutional encoder, we do have a memory inside it. And accordingly, not only the present input bit, but also the previous status is also reflected while generating the corresponding outputs. Now, today I'll be mainly discussing on the block code, and a special kind of block code, which is known as a linear block code. Now, after block code, now let me do more a specific one, that is linear block code, or in short, LBC. Now, before discussing further, let me once again tell you another important terminology. For any particular key, if I have, for example, if any particular block encoder accepts k bits at a time, so obviously you must understand that there could have been 2^k possible input which can be fed to the block encoder, because each of these bits can assume either 0 or 1. So if we have k number of bits together, so I do have almost 2^k number of combinations. If k is equal to 4, I can have 16 combinations, all 0 to all 1, 0, 0, 0, 0 to 1, 1, 1, 1. So I can have altogether 16 combinations, 2^4 combinations. So in general, if I have k number of bits within that particular block, so ultimately the total number of possible combinations will be 2^k. And for each of these 2^k blocks, so the corresponding outputs, obviously the outputs are also unique, because otherwise you cannot segregate the one output to the another one. For example, if I consider that for 1101, the output is equal to 1101101. And if I consider some other bit pattern, like say 1001, and even for this 1001, if the output is the same, then you cannot segregate whether the actual bit was 1101 or 1001. So obviously, the outputs are unique. So there is a one-to-one mapping between this bit pattern, this k number of bits with this one. And the bit patterns which are being generated over here is known as the code word. So this is known as the code word. And the set of all code words will give you the name code. So for 1101, the code word is given by 1101101. This is the code word, and the length of the code word is equal to n. Here, n is equal to 7. So I can have 2 to the power k possible combinations. And for each 2 to the power k possible combinations, we do have 2 to the power k number of distinct and uniquely specified code words. So I can have 2 to the power k distinct code words. And the set of all those 2 to the power k distinct code words is known as the code. That is a collection. This is nothing but the code. Now, what do I mean by linear block code? Now, the linear block code, as the term suggests, means that it's a kind of code for which the summation of two different code words will give you some other code word. For example, if I consider, now let us try to represent the message signal by means of, so this is your LBC, linear block code. Now let us try to represent the message signal by means of this variable M and the corresponding code or code word by means of the variable C. So this is nothing but a vector quantity. So I can write this M as, suppose this can be represented like say M1, M2, M3, up to say MK, or it will be better if I write from 0 itself. Because this is the custom to represent the variables from the 0. So 0, then 1, then 2, and then up to k minus 1. So we have k number of bits, where each mi, can belong to this particular set. Sorry, this will be the second bracket. So it will belong to 0, 1. So either 0 or 1. So I do have altogether k number of bits, M0, M1, M2, up to M of k minus 1. And accordingly, this C, which is nothing but the code word, so this code word can be represented as C0, C1, C2, up to say C of N minus 1. And we have the same set, that is CI can belong to either 0 or 1. So CI can be either 0 or 1. So what do you mean by the linear block code? So here, we do have 2 to the power k number of possible message component, because there could have been k number of possible bits. So, and each of them can assume either 0 or 1. So there could have been 2 to the power k different possibilities. And accordingly, there could have been 2 to the power k number of different code words. So the term linear means that if I have two different code words, like C1 and C2 for say M1 and M2, then if I add them together, C1 plus C2, it will give rise to a new code word which must belong to that particular set. So already I have mentioned that code is nothing but the set of code words. So suppose let it be C3. So code is nothing but the set of code words. So code is nothing but the set of code words. So for M1, for message M1, the corresponding code word is C1, and for message M2, the corresponding code word is C2. Now, if I add these two code words, C1 plus C2, it can give rise to some new code word, say let it be say C12. And C12 must belong to the set, say curly C, where curly C is nothing but the set of all different code words, C1, C2, C3, C4, and so on. Now, if this condition gets satisfied, then it is known as a linear block code kind of thing. Now, if I just consider the architecture of that particular representation, here you see that in the representation of C, we have n number of bits, C0, C1, C2, up to Cn minus 1. And in the representation of the message, we have k number of bits, like M0, M1, M2, up to M of k minus 1. Now, in case of systematic block code, out of these n number of bits, the k number of message bits will be unaltered. What I mean to say is that, let me once again write down the expression for C. Let it be represented by, say, C0. Or say, suppose this is for the ith code word. So it will be like CI0, CI1, CI2, CI3, up to say CIN minus 1. And the corresponding message information, MI, is given by MI0, MI1, MI2, up to MI K minus 1. Now, this C, this code word pertaining to the message MI, this code word CI will be having two different components. One is BI0, BI1, BI2, up to BI N minus K minus 1. And then we do have MI0, MI1, MI2, up to MI K minus 1. Or it could have been like this also. First, we have this K number of message bits, MI0, MI1, up to MI K minus 1. And then we do have the other bits like BI0, BI1, BI2 up to BI N minus K minus 1. N minus K minus 1. So both of these two possibilities are possible. Either you place the consecutive block of the message bits together after this block of BI0, BI1 up to BIN minus K minus 1, or you place this entire block of MI at the very beginning. Now, this particular type of arrangement makes it possible to find out any possibility of error and accordingly correct it. So error detection and error correction will be extremely feasible if the code word is being represented in that particular format, in which case the message information MI0 to MI K minus 1, all the K bits of the message signal can be represented in an unaltered fashion in the code word. And that particular arrangement is known as the systematic block code. So this arrangement is known as systematic block code. Systematic block code. And it helps the error detection and as well as correction. So either you can have this entire block of message information, MI0 to MIK minus 1, at the very beginning of the code word or at the very end of the code word. In which case, that particular code word is known as the systematic block code. Now, apart from this message information, we do have some additional information, which are nothing but the corresponding redundancies. And as I have already mentioned, these redundancies are added in a controlled fashion. Now, how to add these redundancies? Now, in order to add this redundancy, this message information is being utilized, the present message information. For example, this BI0 can be represented as, if I consider the first term, like BI0, that can be represented as some PI0 into MI0 plus some PI1 into MI1 plus some PI2 into MI2 plus dot dot some PI K minus 1 MI K minus 1. Similarly, if I consider the second term like BI1 in this particular expression, then this BI1 can be represented by some other factor, like say PI1 into MI0 plus PI2, or say for BI1 it could have been something different depending upon the nomenclature, and accordingly the bits are generated. So each of these bits, which are known as the generalized parity bits, or in short the parity bits, so these parity bits are generated in accordance with the simple weighted average of the message information. So we do have a weighted average, and the weights are given by this PIJ component. So PIJ will give you the corresponding weight, and accordingly this parity bits are generated from the message bits. Now you have to identify what should be the corresponding representation as far as the matrix formation is concerned. Now, in the matrix form, we can easily find out that the CI, that means the code word, will be having a dimension of 1 cross n. Sorry, since I have represented in the form of this particular way, so we have, let me start with MI first. So this MI, the message information, is being represented by one row, and we have K number of columns, so 1 cross K. And here, the code words are being represented by 1 cross N. So CI, we have two different row vectors appended together. So if I just want to follow the first type of representation, then CI can be represented like some BI and then MI, or in short I can also write the corresponding representation, C is equal to B and then M. Each of them are vectors, each of them are row vectors. So C will be having a dimension of 1 cross n, and B will be having a dimension of, say first of all let me write down the dimension for M, which is nothing but 1 cross k, and for B the dimension is 1 cross n minus k. So 1 cross n, this particular row vector, is being represented by concatenating two different row vectors. One for the message information, that is 1 cross k, and second one is for the parity bits. So this is the message bit, 1 cross k, k number of message bits, and then the parity bits. and the total number of bits in the parity is equal to n minus k. So n minus k plus k will give you the total number of bits in the code word, that is n minus k plus k. Now, how can you get this b from the message information? Already we do have some matrix formation over here. So any particular variable, if I consider bi zero, see, in order to find out this bi zero, I do have certain combination of this p. So I can always represent this entire thing. I can write c as b, and then we have this message information, that is m. And since b is being represented by multiplying the message signal with the corresponding weights, so that can be represented by m into p and m. What is that p? P is nothing but a matrix. Suppose the first one is p00, p01, p02, up to p0 n minus k minus 1. Then it will be p10, p11, p12, as far as the matrix notation is concerned, p1 comma n minus k minus 1. Then p20, p21, p22, p2 comma n minus k minus 1. And accordingly, the last element will be pk minus 1 comma 0, pk minus 1 comma 1, and the last element will be pk minus 1 comma n minus k minus 1. So ultimately, this will complete the formation of the matrix P, and which is having a dimension of k number of rows and n number of n minus k minus 1 number, n minus k number of columns. So the dimension will be k cross n minus k. So we do have k number of rows here, 0 to k minus 1, 0, 0, 1, 0, 2, 0, up to k minus 1, 0. So we have k number of rows and how many columns? 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, 2, up to 0, n minus k minus 1. So n minus k number of columns. So P will be having a dimension of k cross n minus k. Now already we have mentioned that M will be having a dimension of 1 cross k. Now when it is multiplied, when this M is multiplied with P, with a dimension of say k cross n minus k, and from your knowledge in matrix multiplication, you understand that whenever I am going to multiply two matrices, then the column of the first matrix must be equal to the row of the second matrix. So here k, which is the column of the first matrix M, is equal to the row of the second matrix P. So ultimately, if I multiply this M and P, ultimately we have the matrix B. In fact, in this particular case, it will be a row vector with the dimension 1 cross n minus k. So from that, if I take, since MP and M, if I take M outside, so we are left with an identity matrix over here, where IK is nothing but an identity matrix of dimension k, order k. So as you understand, this is the formation of the identity matrix. Only the diagonal elements will be 1 and the rest are 0. And we do have k number of such rows and k number of such columns. It's identity matrix of k cross k. So in this way, the code words are formed. First, the parity bits are, so let me mention that these are the parity bits. First, the parity bits are being represented, and then we do have the message bits. So parity bits and the message bits, or you can have the different representation, first message bit and then the parity bit. But both of them will ultimately give rise to a systematic type of block code. Now, this combination, this PIK, this combination, as you can understand, this combination, will give you, if I just combine it together, so it will give you a new matrix, which is known as the generator matrix. So I can represent C as M into G. And G is the generator matrix, G is known to be the generator matrix. And the combination of message information over here. So here within M, I have considered all the possible values. Here you can have like, so 1 × k. So accordingly, you can have all the 2 to the power k different possible values. And for each of the value of M, I mean, for each of the message information, you can have different code words. Ultimately, this generator matrix it is G. So you have to ensure that there are certain conditions that you must follow over here while considering the construction of the generator matrix. The condition is that the rows of the generator matrix must be linearly independent. So this is the important consideration. Rows of the generator matrix are linearly independent, and which is very essential for the detection of any error. What do you mean by that? Rows of the matrix, rows of this particular generator matrix are linearly independent. That means if I do have 2 different rows of the generator matrix, and if I add them together, under this condition, you cannot have the 3rd row or another row already present within the generator matrix. Or in other words, if I consider, if I arbitrarily select any 2 different rows from the generator matrix, and if I add them together, the resultant value will not be present or must not be present as another row already present in the generator matrix. And while I'm talking about this addition of bits, and as you can understand, each and every element within the generator matrix or the message bits or the parity bits or the code words, so they can assume either 0 and 1. So multiplying with 0, multiplying with 1 doesn't have any confusion over here. But whenever we add to signal, like say 1 plus 1, so under this condition, so this addition must be a modulo 2 addition, because ultimately what do we have is a set of information in the form of 0 and 1. So if I have like 1 plus 1, so that must be equal to 1. Otherwise, it cannot belong to the set 0, 1. So therefore, we do have certain rules, and which is known as the modulo 2 rule. And perhaps you know this one. Still, I would like to mention the multiplication and addition rule, because in the matrix multiplication, you need to multiply the elements, and accordingly you need to add. So what are the multiplication rules? So 0 into 0 is equal to 0, 0 into 1 is equal to 0, 1 into 0 is equal to 0, and 1 into 1 is equal to 1. So well-known rule, and 0 plus 0 will be equal to 0, 0 plus 1 will be equal to 1, 1 plus 0 will be equal to 1, and 1 plus 1 is not equal to 2, rather this is equal to 0. So this is the, basically, we do have an exclusive OR operation, XOR operation over here. So instead of mentioning it like a simple OR operation, addition operation, the operation is XOR. If both of the elements are identical, then the output will be 0. And if they are not identical, then it will be 1. The output will be 1. So whenever we do have 2 different rows of the generator matrix, so, and if I add those 2 different rows, then ultimately the resultant output must not match with any of the rows inside the generator matrix. If this condition is true, in that case, you can properly detect and correct any error which has been already present inside the received code word. Now, while talking about the properties of the linear block code, I have mentioned that the condition which must be true over here is that if I have two different code words, then the summation of the two different code words must give you the third code words in that particular code. Now, to understand that particular property, which is known as the closure property, you have to once again consider the basic equation from which this has been developed. The basic equation is that C is equal to M into G. C is equal to M into G. So if I have two different message bits like MI and MJ, so the corresponding code words will be like CI can be written by MI into G, because the governing equation is this one. This is the governing equation, a generating equation. So that's why the matrix G is known as the generator matrix. So this is the generating equation. And if the message information is MJ, so the corresponding code word is given by MJ into G. Now, if I add them together, so CI plus CJ, so this is nothing but MI plus MJ into G. Now, MI plus MJ, obviously, this will be a new message information already existing within these 2^k sets. Remember, if I consider the message information, now there are altogether k number of bits within the message information. So if I have k number of bits, so there could have been 2^k possible message bit pattern. But however, for the code words, since the mapping is unique mapping from one message information to one code information, one message vector to one code vector or code word, so that particular code C will also be having 2^k number of possible values. Although the length of the code word is equal to n, but we don't have all the 2^n number of possible combinations. We do have only 2^k number of possible code words corresponding to each of the 2^k number of possible message information. So if I add MI plus MJ, obviously you must appreciate that this summation of MI plus MJ will give you some another message information already existing within the message set, because we have extensively studied all the message information, all the message bits, 2^k bits. So this MI plus MJ will give you some new message bit. Let it be say M dashed. And whenever this M dashed is multiplied with this generator matrix, it will give you a corresponding code word, that is C dashed. And this C dashed must belong to the code curly C, because this M dashed must also belong to the message vector set, because this entire expression has been developed for all the 2^k number of possible message information. So CI plus CJ is equal to some another code word within the curly C. So therefore, I can say that this particular construction abides by the rule of closure. So rule of closure is followed. Rule of closure is followed. That means if I add two different code words pertaining to two different message words or message information, that is MI and MJ, the resultant information is also another code word within the code, within the curly C. So if I would like to represent this entire thing by means of a black box, how does it look like? So encoder or block encoder is characterized by this generator matrix, and whenever I have some M message information over here, and the corresponding code words will be generated in accordance with this particular formula, that is C is equal to M into G. And whenever this code word is being transmitted through the channel, then there is a possibility that the corresponding bits, any of the bits or more than one bit of the code word, might be distorted. So we do have certain mechanism to detect whether the code word that you have received belongs to that particular set or not. So to do that, let us devise another matrix, that is H. And this matrix H is given by I n minus k. P transpose. Already we have talked about P, whose size was k cross n minus k, so k number of rows and n minus k number of columns. This will be M. So H is nothing but, let us devise another matrix, which is devised in this way, I n minus k. So I n minus k is nothing but the identity matrix. Of size n minus k. That means n minus k number of rows and n minus k number of columns. On the other hand, we do have a P matrix whose size was k cross n minus k. That means k number of rows and n minus k number of columns. So if I have the matrix P transpose, so P transpose will be having n minus k number of rows and k number of columns, n minus k cross k, P transpose. Because whenever you perform the transpose operation of any matrix, the number of rows and number of columns will be interchanged. So P transpose will be having n minus k number of rows and k number of columns. So therefore, whenever you are going to append this I n minus k, this matrix with the another matrix that is P transpose, so the corresponding rows should be the same. So here we have n minus k number of rows, and this P transpose will be having n minus k number of rows. So ultimately, this matrix H will be having a dimension of n minus k rows. And how many columns? N minus k columns for I and another k columns for P transpose. So the size of this matrix H will be N minus k cross N. Already we do have another matrix, that is G. We have already developed that matrix, the generator matrix. So G was like that. That matrix G, P and IK. So we have the matrix P having a row of k and column of n minus k and ik, the identity matrix of psi k, so k cross k. So what will be the dimension of G? So the dimension of G is nothing but we have k number of rows and n number of columns. P will be having k number of rows and n minus k number of columns, and ik will be having k number of rows and k number of columns. So since the matrix are appended in this order, so the number of columns will be added together, so it will be having a dimension of k cross n. So this can readily be verified from the generated equation C is equal to m into g. Once again, if you just follow this equation, so here m is having a dimension of 1 cross k and g is having a dimension of k cross n. So therefore, if you multiply them together, m into g, so the C matrix, I mean the C vector, will be having a dimension of 1 cross n. So as apparent from the matrix multiplication formula. So now, if I carry out this operation, if I carry out g, if this g, so I cannot multiply g with h directly because g is having a dimension of k cross n and h is having a dimension of n minus k cross n. So in order to multiply g, I need to take the transpose of h. So if I find out this g h transpose, so g h transpose is nothing but so here we do have p matrix, then we have this ik. So these are the two partitions, and here we do have I n minus k, and then we have P over here. Or it will be better if I write down in the previous form. That is I n minus k p transpose, this is h, and then transpose. So as far as the property of the modulo 2 operation is concerned, and as far as the property of matrix multiplication is concerned, you understand that whenever you multiply these two matrices together, g with h transpose, the result will be a zero, the null matrix, the null matrix we have with the dimension of k cross n minus k. The resultant matrix will be null matrix with dimension of k cross n minus k. So g h transpose will be equal to zero. Similarly, you can also check that h into g transpose is also equal to zero. So already we do have this particular formula that c is equal to m into g. So therefore, if I post multiply each of the matrices with the H transpose, if I post multiply them, so ultimately we do have C H transpose equal to M into G into H transpose. Now already I've seen that M G G into H transpose will give you a null matrix of dimension k cross n minus k. So ultimately the resultant will be equal to zero. So whenever now let us come back to the receiver part or the decoder part. In the encoder part, we have seen that if m is the message signal on the set of k bits and which are being provided at the input of the encoder, and ultimately it will generate the code words in accordance with that particular formula, that is c is equal to m into g. And when this code word is being transmitted through the channel, and there is a possibility that some of the bits might be corrupted, might be distorted due to the presence of the channel noise. And if I want to identify whether that particular bit which we have received is correct or is properly received or not, then we do have some mechanism, and that mechanism has been identified in the decoder block. So in the decoder block, to check whether the received code word is a correct one or not, so in the decoder, we do have the matrix H. So in the encoder, we have the matrix G, and in the decoder, we have the matrix H. And as you can understand that if I know the formulation of G, I can easily find out the formulation of H, because G has been formulated using the identity matrix and the P matrix, and the elements of P are nothing but the corresponding weights, where each of them can assume either 0 or 1. And similarly, if I know G, I can easily find out what is H. Now, whenever at the input of the decoder, I do have a code word like C, here your objective will be to check whether the received code word is the correct one or not. So in order to check that, I have to perform this operation C into H transpose. Now, if this C into H transpose, if this is equal to 0, that signifies that the code word is a valid one. Is a valid one. Because until and unless this code word is not a valid code word, then C into H transpose will not give you 0, because C is equal to M into G. And if I multiply C with H transpose, then only you can have M into G into H transpose, and then only you can have the null matrix over here, 0. So if this C does not belong, suppose C, if C does not belong to this particular Curly C. So what is that Curly C? Is nothing but the set of all 2 to the power k code words. So this Curly C is set of all possible, set of all possible 2 to the power k code words. So this is Curly C code words. Now, if the C, any code word, if it can belong to this Curly C, then only this C into H transpose will be equal to 0. But if C does not belong to that, then C into H transpose will not be equal to 0. So if I have a code word received at the input of the decoder, and if the resultant value C into H transpose will give you a null matrix, then only you can say that the code word is a valid code word, or it belongs to the set of possible, all possible 2 to the power k code words. If not, then you must, the decoder must mention that the received code word is the detected one, you know, which you have decoded by means of this black box, is not a genuine code word. So error is detected. So error can be detected by checking the result of this particular matrix multiplication, C into H transpose. If C into H transpose gives you a null matrix, then you can say that there is no error, so it has been detected properly. And if C is H transpose, if this is not equal to 0, then you can say that if this resultant value is not a null matrix, then you can say that the received code word that you have received at the input of the decoder is not a genuine one. And so therefore, obviously some error has been crept into the code word. However, there could have been a difficult scenario over here. That means, suppose, let me tell you very briefly, and that particular aspect will be discussed in much more detail in the next class. Now, suppose you have transmitted, let us consider a scenario. Suppose from the transmitter side, so this is the transmitter side, you have transmitted the code word C1. And this is the channel. And during its excursion through the channel, suppose the code word C1 has been modified by the external noise. And suppose the modification is such that the signal that you are receiving at the input of the decoder is a different code word from the same set Curly C. But the C1 is not equal to the same C2. It's a different code word, but it's a valid code word. Now, whenever you consider the receiver side or the decoder side over here, So once again, if you just perform that particular operation, that C into H transpose or C2 into H transpose, obviously the result will be equal to zero. So the decoder might feel that since the code word which I am receiving over here is a valid code word, since it belongs to the curly C, so that's why C into H transpose equal to zero. So there will be a misclassification problem that even if the error is there, because you have transmitted C1 from the transmitter end, a valid code word, and you are receiving something which is not equal to C1, but another valid code word, right? So under this condition, the result will be equal to zero. So the decoder might feel that code word which has been received, so there was no error, because otherwise if the error was there, in that case, this C into H transpose result will not be equal to zero. Since the result equal to zero, so the received code word is properly detected and there was no error. But however, the scenario is just the reverse. You have sent some information, C1, but you have received a different set of code words, and ultimately the detector cannot identify that the error is present. And automatically, since the error is not at all detected, so there is no provision of correction. So this is one of the biggest limitation of this linear block code. So suppose you have transmitted one code word, but you have received a different code word, but the decoder will not be able to identify that the error has been crept into the code word. So we'll be discussing the different properties of this linear block code in much more detail in the next class, when we'll be talking about the error detection and error correction capability of that particular code. Primary discussion, the introductory lecture on this linear block.